Morning from another beautiful day in Marsh Harbour in the Abacos and another Technical Tuesday episode. Now today what I want to talk to you about is essential engine checks for your boat engine before you set off on trips, on passages, just to make sure that when you're at sea, all the little problems that may have needed to be addressed have been addressed and you're not trying to fix them in a seaway. It's simple, it's easy, these checks will take less than 5 minutes to do, but they may save you a load of grief in the future. Okay, so essential engine checks. Before we do anything here, it is like super, super, super important that we talk about safety. These engines can be ridiculously dangerous. Under no circumstances will you ever do these checks with the engine running. It is kind of like there's moving components down here. You could, what is it they says in the manual? Serious injury or death. And for once they're not messing around. You can injure yourself. So the engine is off at this point. So that's the first thing. Second thing is, when we do the first check, and that is to check our engine oil, the engine oil needs to be warm to check efficiently. The manual for our Yanmar says about 10 minutes. We've run it for about 20 minutes now just to make sure that we've got warm oil, but that means that the engine is hot. So please, please be careful that you do not burn yourself on this engine. So again, a lot of caution. With our boat, we have a small engine and a very small engine compartment, so the working spaces that we have are restricted. We have huge amounts of boat envy where you find, you know, big engine compartments, engine rooms even, where there's amazing access. You work with what you're given, and this is what we have. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to check the engine oil. We're going to check those levels to make sure they're within the correct parameters, and then top the oil up if necessary. First thing to do with engine oil checks is to make sure, as I've said, you've got a warm engine oil. Locate the dipstick on your boat, take the dipstick out, clean it and put it all the way back in. Make sure it is really well seated. Pull it out and check the levels. There are normally two marks, an upper and a lower mark. On the dipstick, make sure that your oil levels are within those marks. That's all you need to do. As long as you have changed the oil regularly, we change our oil once a season. So the oil doesn't need changing, but the levels do need to be checked. So engine oil, absolutely where I want it to be. It is midpoint between the upper and the lower levels. We don't need to add any more engine oil at the moment. However, when we are on passage, we always keep 5 liters of oil handy. And it is really important that you do not overfill your engine. If you have to add oil, add it slowly. Add maybe half a pint at a time and just check the levels. So if you overfill an engine, you can really cause huge amounts of damage. So make sure that if you're topping up engine oil rather than putting a whole new lot in because you have changed the oil, just top it up slowly. Okay, job number two is checking the alternator belt tension. Now this is important. The alternator provides electricity and charges your batteries, but the belt on a lot of engines, our engine included, and every boat I've ever had, it does three things. Firstly, it's driven by the engine to turn the alternator, but it also has a third wheel which drives the water pump. So your alternator belt tension has to be checked to make sure it's not slipping. Now you will hear if your alternator is slipping, you will hear like kind of, when you start the engine at low revs, you hear it squeaking. You know, squeal a little bit and you're like, what's that squealing? It needs to be checked and the tension adjusted if you have a slipping alternator. We had one the other week. It is super, super easy to adjust. With our alternator, there has to be about 1 centimeter or half an inch of give in the belt when you use manual pressure just to move it. So basically find your alternator belt. Ours is covered in a plastic cover, but you can feel it. And pull against it with a light resistance. If it moves less than a centimeter, that's okay. If it moves more than that, or if you hear squeaking, you need to change the tension on the alternator. And that's a really simple thing to do. Obviously, the engine is off when you do this. Otherwise, you will end up with less fingers than you started with. So let's go ahead and check that now. So we've checked the belt tension. The belt was slipping the other week, so the marks on my fingers are alternator belt dust. That for me is not a lot to worry about because I can still feel the ridges on the alternator. It's not worn to any significant degree. We obviously carry spare alternator belts, oil filters, fuel filters, so that if we do have a problem, we have a change out, and especially apart from that, the impeller. Now, if you do need to adjust your alternator belt tension, what we have to do, literally, we loosen two nuts on the alternator attachment point. We have a Yanmar alternator, and most Yanmar alternators have, there's just two bolts holding them in place. So you loosen the one, you loosen one, loosen the other, and then move the alternator into position. You move it away generally from the engine, and that will increase the tension. Sometimes you need two people to do this. You need someone to kind of hold the alternator out. We normally use like a large spanner just to hold it out and then retighten the nuts. That normally takes a couple of minutes, and I'll show you where those nuts are. Job number three to do on our regular engine checks, and that is to check the raw water strainer. So that's the engine water cooling strainer. It's down there. Now what this does, it's basically a little filter that strains any debris out of the raw water intake, the salt water intake, to make sure that you don't end up sucking anything into the engine. Now, it's really important that you check this regularly to make sure it's not blocked, because what will happen is if you do not check it and your engine blocks up, you'll end up with an overheating engine and you'll be like, oh, I've got to stop the engine. Always at the most inopportune moment. It tends to happen more if you're sailing in rivers, streams and estuaries, because there's a lot more debris in the water, but yeah, it happens here. So let's check that and see what we need to do. Okay, so I can see that there is debris in that strainer. It was checked about 3 weeks ago. We will clean it out again. It's a simple, simple job. Really important, please close the seacock before you take the strainer apart. Otherwise, you'll end up with a lot of water in your boat. And equally importantly, when you have finished taking the strainer apart and putting it back together, open the seacock. What we tend to do, and what we've done before to make sure that we never start the engine with the seacock on, is leave the keys for the engine on the handle of the seacock. Then you can't start your engine without. So we'll get on and do that. It's a simple job. Close the seacock, open the strainer, clean it out, put it back together. Should take about 10 minutes. Debris out of that. As I've said to you in previous videos, we keep our old toothbrushes just for cleaning, and this is one of those amazing jobs that an old used toothbrush, don't mix them up, will make a really good job of cleaning this filter out. It's almost completely clean, but we've got dishwater here that we used to wash up earlier. We're just going to clean it out a little bit and then drain the water. So quick brush with the old toothbrush, get any debris out of that just to make sure it's nice and clean, just to make sure. The other thing is, you know, if you're in an area where there's a lot of silt, which again tends to be river estuaries, you find that these silt up quickly, and silt can block the gauze of the filter. So again, it's good practice when you clean this out or you find it blocked to give it a good clean. Okay, now this is a little bit fastidious and it's quite nerdy, but it is good practice if you are removing nuts and bolts from something. Try and put the nuts and the bolts, or the nuts or the bolts, back into the same holes they came from. Only because sometimes threads are slightly different, and therefore it's useful to know exactly what order you took the nuts out in. So we have a circular filter here which has four bolts to go through it. Now I always start with by using the analogy of a clock face. So I start with the bolt that is closest to midday and then work clockwise round. So the first bolt is at about 2 o'clock, the second's at 5, the third is at 7, and the fourth is at 10. So I know which, I label those 1, 2, 3, and 4, and these are put from left to right, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So I know that when I go to put this back together, they are going back exactly in the same holes. It just, well, it's slightly nerdy of me, but I know that it's gone in the right place. Okay, so those nuts were just hand tightened. Don't over tighten them, just good hand strength. If you want to use a torquing wrench, you can do. I never found a use or a need for with this sort of procedure. And then what I said, reopen that C-cop, because if you don't, you're gonna have problems. So let's get that done straight away. Okay, another quick job to do is to make sure that your stuffing box, if you've got a stern drive driven boat, is dripping at the correct rate. For us, it's one drop of water per second or up to about 10 seconds. That ensures correct cooling. If it is leaking more than that, or you are finding your bilge is filling with water, check the stern drive stuffing box and adjust it if necessary. Now, it's super important that if you do adjust it, you adjust only a little bit at a time. We suggest 1/4 turn and eyeball it to make sure that if you've got a packing box that both sides are even, that they're parallel to each other. If they're not parallel, you will end up either scoring the stern drive, the stern shaft, or causing problems later on. Okay, now these are the two plates that we're talking about here that need to be looked at. There will be a drip from under there. Never, ever, ever put your hands in this area with the engine on. Because we're filming, we haven't got the engine on, or you would not be able to hear what we're doing. But essentially, it's these two plates. You loosen off this nut and then tighten this nut. And these two plates have to be parallel. So you make sure that you adjust both evenly. Again, we've checked this. There's no need to adjust this at the moment, but it does need to be checked regularly. And one last check we do regularly, just making sure we've got enough cooling fluid. This tends to not need topping up that often, but there are two levels. When the engine cold, check the levels and top it up with either we use water and or a proprietary cooling fluid, which has got an antifreeze and some engine protective properties in it. So that's something to check as well. Then you're kind of ready to go. There are other checks that we perform periodically, for instance, you know, to make sure that the pumps aren't dripping, to make sure that the elbow is not dripping. But again, these are checks that I would expect you to do every time you start the engine or before you start the engine, just to make sure that you're ready to go. All in all, I can do these checks now in probably under a minute. It's just good practice and it really does promote safety at sea. So that's that for now. We can start the engine, get on our way. Thank you so much for watching. We hope you enjoyed that. Another technical episode next Tuesday, dealing with another aspect of boat life, boat hacks and boat fixes. Please subscribe so that you never miss another episode. Also, we've got all our social media down below. We've got Facebook, we've got Twitter, we've got Instagram, and we've got Snapchat. Those four social medias will let you see what we're doing behind the scenes, outtakes, things we do on a daily basis that we don't put into our videos. So I hope you like that, and we will see you next week. Thanks very much.